Okay, and you should be seeing me. Well, looks like we've made our way back to each other, or forward to each other, as I always say, again, and we're on the AstroQuest platform. Obviously, I was definitely preparing a show for the radio, so I'm gonna need a second to get acclimated because actually we've been relocating here, and so all the studio equipment was literally unhooked and things. So we got up early this morning and we started getting right into hooking everything back up so that we can broadcast this show to you live. I got a notification from the host from Sense Radio that they're not gonna be able to have the radio today for personal reasons. And so I just said, man, this happened about 10:30 last night after I had gotten the flyers and everything together and sent things out to people. And I said, man, I just can't on a Sunday because everyone expects for us to be broadcasting anyway. Just, say to everyone, hey, we're not going to be here today, and it's the we're going to have to return when I get on another radio show. I just couldn't do it. And obviously, I felt like even though the show right now we're going into season three, some people are asking, why does the sign say season four? And I say, well, season three takes place on the astral plane. But we're going into season three now, and there's a lot of information that's been coming to me again. And it's a greater refinement, I would say, as to the message that's being presented. And that happens all week. Like, we're here every single day and we're expanding into new stuff. And so I felt like today, even though there was, the host couldn't do it in the UK, and then obviously the equipment wasn't hooked up, I felt like the universe was like, hey, I need you to get out this message. That's all we really talked about, is just getting this message out. So I made sure that I went ahead and got in line and started to just think about, well, what has been going on for the last 48 hours? And what that's been mainly about is alchemy, and somewhat of a surface understanding of alchemy, because there's obviously some people that go really deep in it, some too deep. But the surface understanding has a great deal of application for you to realize what's happening on Earth. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take a moment, I'm going to get a drink of water, I'm going to get to the board here, and I'm also going to make sure that we're broadcasting with audio and video and everything properly, and then we're going to get started. Okay. So it does look like everything is working. It was interesting because right when I hit start on the live stream box, then the power went out very briefly and came back on. And I said, man, there must be a lot of energy associated with that show. Something came in disturbing the electromagnetic signal. You know how high levels of magnetics don't really get along well with electronic items. So sometimes, of course, you send it away. And we're going to talk a lot about that today. We're going to talk about exactly how Earth's put together, why we're experiencing what we're experiencing, and how to expand even beyond this current geometry and how even geometry works. So this is an intense, more or less a candid interview. I really wanted to today transcend the whole show. How can I say, blueprint or prototype that we generally go by, which you'll see a lot more in season three, is we're going to go and do something completely different. We don't have to obey any rules or laws or barriers or guidelines. We only need to walk through the door and come into the quintessence or the higher level of our existence, and because that's what we are. And so let me go ahead and make my transition to the board. I have some things that I want to talk about in the closing of the show today, and let me just look over this completely. First of all, I want to say thank you tons to all the individuals that are actually involved in the resistance and making sure that that message gets out. Also making sure that we transcend our minute levels of understanding and expanding into something completely different. And so I wanted to say to people, thank you, and also welcome to the next expanded level of your consciousness. And I'm obviously enjoying the space and sharing the space as much as I can. So yeah, let me get to the board. I think everyone likes me more on the board in a sense of being able to understand some of the complex stuff. So obviously today's title is Earth Explained. By the way, when it comes to spelling these days, I seem to only see the word as it is. So if you see some typos and things, just realize it's because I have this I for words, and it's now got me to the point where I'm not seeing words anymore. Like, I'm not seeing D's as D's, I'm seeing them as pyramids, and I'm not seeing E's as E's anymore. So Earth Explained, okay? I'll keep this way over here so that way We understand the title of today's actual dissertation on what is going on here. And I first will start off with this symbol, which is known as the symbol of Earth. Like if you go into astrology, you'll find that this is the symbol of Earth. It's not necessarily the alchemical symbol of Earth, because Earth in itself has a weird name, because Earth to us means soil, right? So if Earth was like a specific name, like Candarthia, then like a person, you know, a person's name, you know, James or Thomas or Kishan or John. So people have names, and those names designate their function. So name equals function, okay? So if Earth's name is Aya or Tiamat or whatever the name may be, then we can interpret this name based on its etymology and meaning to the ancients, and also the symbol that's embedded within the words. However, Earth's name happens to correspond to an element. So it does let you know that someone or something believes that Earth's primary purpose is for Earth or soil. Okay? So the first thing I wanted to draw really briefly is this, what I just call the crosshair. Okay? And we're going to draw some notches here. So just give me a moment to get the board set up the way that it needs to be set up for today's transmission. Right. Also, we're going to check periodically to make sure the sound and everything is okay, because we know that we're using some of live stream stuff and it has a tendency to drop out and stuff like that, especially when we're getting to the good parts. So let me take a look really briefly over here. Okay. Great. So now, what we come to is the four elements. Because these four elements will actually allow you to understand what's taking place on Earth. And if you know what's going on here, that's what I say, if you at least master one system, if you know what's going on here, then you also will know what's going on in other dimensions. And also what alchemy will teach you is alchemy is a working of the soul. So alchemy is work on the soul, all right? And the reason this is important is because everything contains a soul. Ants contain a soul. Humans, of course, contain a soul. You have extraterrestrials, as they love to call them. They contain some kind of spirit force or soul, mainly more of the ethereal, okay? So, or the soul is more associated with ethereal. So the reality here is that what we're talking about today is something that works on everything. This is not just exclusive to the human being. So what you'll find here first is the alchemical symbol of the cross, and this folds out into this because it folds out into the four elements, right? Or the four, in a tense, it's the four doors, and I'll explain this word doors, because a door, right, or the four okay, and the wall and the law, the boundaries or the boundary and the rule, okay, are all governed at this point, okay? So I'm going to explain it again. So what you have is a door, but what is a door doing? A door is separating you from the other room. So you need a wall to have a door, right? So the door is what is, again, separating you from the other side. So when you walk through a door, you get to the other side. So the purpose of the door, or the purpose of four, is basically the wall or the law, the rule or the boundary, meaning that, hey, the reason why you can't go into your neighbor's house right now and see what your neighbor is doing is because they have a door, and that door allows them to have a certain level of privacy, right? So what you need to see now is that the training that takes place here on Earth is based more on the number three transitioning into the number 4, then transitioning into the number 5, and then ad infinitum, even going in the other direction, especially since it's closer, meaning going back down to 1 and then merging at times because it's closer. So what happens is that you have this reality that's developed then in degrees, and I'm going to explain to you why they put the Jesus guy, even though it's on the unbalanced cross, on this cross, or as the original symbol shows, a man in the pentagram strapped to the pentagram, or sometimes you'll see it in the Sumerian as a man stuck in the spokes of a wheel. Okay, this is the occult symbolism, and this is why the occult symbolism lends volumes of knowledge for the one who is educated in understanding what it really means, but volumes of ignorance and foolishness for the one who takes the base or the gross interpretation of it, right? And I want everyone to think of this word today, the gross or dense interpretation of something versus the, let's say for instance, refined, okay? The refined or purified, right? We'll use that term today, okay? So the gross or dense interpretation versus the refined and purified interpretation. So as we go into this, what you'll realize is that the cross symbolism has everything to do with human beings, not just a man on the cross, but human beings on this cross, right? Or this wheel. And what this wheel is consists of are the elements fire, water. Excuse me, we got two waters going on here. This should be air. Excuse me. So fire, air, water, earth. Okay? So what happens is that this becomes the explanation on why many people have a hard time changing, because in each of these tenses, and we'll put some numbers here really briefly, right? This is going by no particular laws, rules, structures, edicts, decrees, or whatever. We're using this all for, all for metaphorical purposes in order to mark or designate, miss five over here. It's like, man, trust me, all this stuff to me now, it rolls into the number 0, and my mind collapses it and then begins high spin. Because when you're dealing with this kind of rudimentary building block stuff, you move very slow like a block. It moves like a block in your brain or square wheel, which doesn't rotate very well, okay? So what you're dealing with then here is that these are what I'll call and we'll designate today the degrees, okay? Because we talked before about the degrees of the fire and why fire is always measured in degrees. But we've come to understand that air has its degrees, earth has its degrees, and these degrees denote how far it is away from its dense or gross state versus its purified or refined state, okay? So every reincarnation, and this is what it's talked about, there's a greater ancient and organic wheel that we're going through that seeks to refine and perfect us so that way we reach quintessence, which is basically the merging of all of our abilities to unlock within ourselves basically the straight pipeline of Kundalini or Chi, which brings us into a graduated state of consciousness. Until then, what you get is notice that on people's node chart, and we'll just draw a rudimentary node chart here, right? And then they show the astrological houses. Excuse me, I'm probably doing a horrible job. My stick men are still beautiful. But then you have the astrological signs, right? And then they say, oh, you have 30 degrees in the house of Aries and 90 degrees with Sagittarius. And then they draw you out this node chart, right? And what this node is based on is your degrees of creation. That's why it connects to how much light you give off. It's connected to why you have individuals that are extremely polarized or extremely airy, extremely fiery or extremely earthly or extremely watery, because these are archetypes. Okay? I think that's right. Archetypes. To say it is as fire as we understand it, it transcends just the fire that you see when you light a lighter. It transcends into a level of understanding the temperament, mainly the temperament. This is the key word, the temperament of the element. Like a fiery individual likes and dislikes certain things, just like an airy individual likes and dislikes certain things. So these weights and measures of degrees equal the person. So what you're really trying to do, and this is why it's also hidden within the symbol of the pyramid, but from the top, meaning that if you are seeing it when it's in front of you, it just looks like this. So thus, this is the system that you get stuck in, right? And this is about, as we know, the generation cycles, right? But when you see it from the top, everyone says X means stop. Right? It means that instead of the continuous combustion, which is hidden within many symbols, you can go 1, 2, 3, 4 quintessence. See, there's a fifth point on top of the pyramid that designates how your energy is supposed to flow. So if this is your body, if you see yourself standing up, just like we saw the image of the cross being basically an image of a person, if this is your body, what you're seeking to do is come into the center of yourself. Okay? And to explain that a lot more clear, is that you can see yourself then as you have this spine, and Kundalini needs to make it to the, Kundalini needs to be activated. And the only way for it to activate it is for it to come through the center. So if you're 5 degrees of fire and 2 to 3 degrees of air and 9 degrees of water and let's say 6 degrees of earth, this makes you a certain kind of person. And so if you're not doing alchemy on yourself, you can get lost in this world, this crucible, because that's what this symbol means. It means a crucible. It's a place where something, once it emancipates itself, will become 1,000 times stronger. So this is when we get into later on of how the alchemy is being worked on us now. Like, they are master alchemists that understand how to change the temperament of the people around the world based on utilizing the elements as sculpture, for a sculpturing purpose. Because it's important, as me and Thomas were talking about, that you begin to realize that, first of all, then, how is this shaping and molding and refining even being done? What is the tool being used to do that? You have to go back to the simplicity of thought. If something is to be done, if something is to be molded and shaped and fashioned, then we surely would need a hammer or some kind of tool to do that with. So what is the tool? Fire, air, water, earth. The alchemist has these tools and can sculpt their own world. But we have alchemists that are choosing to sculpt everyone else's world by utilizing these principles to cause the change that will come about when they utilize those principles, meaning that this is how you create the future on earth. And that's one thing that we need to realize, that this knowledge here is the graduation of earth, because it's once you bring yourself into balance, bing, 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 then what happens is your body is now in balance, so the Kundalini begins to rise up the center, then it goes up the spine, and then it comes out of the top of the head, and then you eject from the environment, right? So the next thing here is that we started talking about the difference between the gross or the dense versus the refined and the purified, okay? And the reason why is that when we're dealing with things like fire, because they say what brings you closer to this centering of yourself is to begin to refine yourself, right? So we wanted to understand what is over here, because this is what the archons are, okay? Right? Why? They are the shape or the molders or the refiners. Okay? Why? Because they are archetypes. Okay? And why? Because they are polarized. Right? So they've chose to hang out on 9 degrees of fire. No water at all. Real gross. Why? Because what happens is when an individual begins to think of only the gross or the dense interpretation of what they are, we only can see that within the elements, okay? And the elements and the minerals, because they have their own story. And we'll talk today later on about lead. But right now we're going to talk about gold, okay? It's just as an example, and silver as an example, okay? So the person that is very gross or dense uses gold for only financial purposes on the physical dimension, or maybe even wears it as a jewelry, etc., right? But the more refined the individual, so that's what the gross or the dense mind thinks of its use, right? But the more refined individual starts thinking in the refined or purified state of gold, it becomes like the colloidal gold, which is colloidals are made by putting an arc through water as a birthing pool and then spitting out small ions of it that are ingestible, right? So all what this has to do, this harmony, is about being refined and purified so that way you can connect with other elements without contaminating them. That's really what you're looking at here in the refinement and the purification of self. So this, the gross and the dense person then thinks of gold only as, again, for their physicality, while the more ethereal person, the refined person in their consciousness, is thinking of it in a monatomic or colloidal level. Same thing with silver. Someone may create some kind of silver vase or something of that nature and say, oh, silver has a very lustrous, shiny look. I like it. And this is like the whole golem personality. I like the color of silver, and they shine it, and then they put it on the counter in the room, and then they look at it, and then, you know, a couple weeks later, they're not even thinking about it anymore. But this is the only physical understanding of the silver. Not, hey, why don't we just melt this cup down, make it into two rods, then create a wave current that turns this into colloidal silver. Then we can apply it to our body and start killing the bacteria that's within our body and start making that transition into a higher spin. Now, the term that I use, again, is high spin, because through lifetimes, okay, through lifetimes, you go through these degrees, and you may start out here on the 9 degree, and as your lifetimes go, you start spiraling back in to yourself, right? Centripetal or centrifugal, though. Some people are spiraling out. They're getting more polarized. They're coming out into these other zones and adding other things, but the more grosser explanation and interpretation of it, and this is what I've noticed is happening a lot in the spiritual world now, is that people's interpretation of what an extraterrestrial is, what a UFO may be, what a cross means, what an archon is, all of these kind of explanations are generally gross and dense. So the visualization that the individual gets from that will not allow them to go into centering themselves. It only will allow them to polarize themselves further. Oh, I hate them, right? So if you hate fire, what do you become? Water. But water is seeking to get to fire. Many of these degrees lower down, fire is seeking to get to water. Many of these degrees down here are making their transition or warring with these elements down here. So, but through these mediaries, and this is another thing that you need to understand about mediaries. Fire and water are the two opposite poles. Fire is never going to become water. Water is never going to become fire unless they make the transition to earth or air. And this is very important, because you need to ask yourself, are we as human beings now acting or reacting into the show where we're playing the mediators between two polarized subjects or topics, standards in a tense. And let me go into this. This chessboard. Because there's two things or three things you should see on the chessboard become important and connect with what we're talking about. And that is that on a chessboard, let's just draw it from this side, right? And you have the pieces here, right? And then the pieces here, I guess, rudimentary chessboard, right? Right? And then you have the black ones, obviously, and then you have the white ones, and then you have the rest of the spectrum in between, right? So this is, let's say this is white, okay? And this is black, right? But these are colors, okay? And only clear is the absence of color, right? But they'll tell you, well, black is the absence of color, white's the absence of color. No, they only clear is the absence of color. Black and white are their own colors. But what is in between here is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, okay? So you have these other colors that when white is on this side and it pushes into the adjacent color, which, you know, ultraviolet and higher ultraviolet, then eventually gets into white, then you have red, far infrared, finally gets into black, and then you have their expressions. So this is moving the pieces across the board. Okay, go to war, right? And then they send out the expressions. And this is to hold the line, meaning that these two go back and forth with these wars to maintain the center of the board. But what you have to realize is the hidden hand. And that's every bit of a hand. It's the person who is, or being, who is moving the pieces. You never know what kind of finger it may be. But the hand of whoever is moving these pieces is what we need to understand. Sometimes we get into the queen or the black queen or the white queen or the black king or the black bishop or the white pope. You see what I mean? So we get into all these different dynamics on the board. Meanwhile, our lives are being wasted away. We are on time, and this is why time is connected with these three things. Okay? And then it gets into dents. And it gets into non-conductivity, right? And it gets into bones, okay? And this is the entire Saturnalian principle, because Saturnalian, the metal of Saturn, is lead. So lead does not become affected by light. It actually affects light. So this is big news to these light workers when they're thinking they're going to get rid of these Saturnalians, when they need to focus on just what they're doing with their own personal alchemy and then take the great glass elevator and climb the spine and go into the other dimensions that have less gross impurities. That's what you should be focusing on. But if you're dealing with old lead head, meaning that if you're trying to change a Saturnalian principle, take lead and then attempt to send a frequency through it. It deadens it out. In fact, if you put a lead dome over something, there's no reception because the signals can't get in. What does this say? This means that Saturn, the Saturnalian principle, is what remains after everything is gone. Everything is pushed itself into the wrong direction and then made itself decay. And then it becomes lead. This is when, if you stay into your metallic states, I'm gold, I'm silver, you stay into these states, you'll find that all these metals transcend themselves eventually into gold after their fanfare, meaning after they run out of all the energy and then they start becoming corrosive and then non-conductive, then they start to actually become lead. That's what makes a Saturnalian. And then there is no feelings because there's no frequency, right? And so these principles and laws, this is universal law, it interprets so many things about what we're experiencing in our reality, but it also lets us know personally what we may be doing that is going to have no effect and is going to be wasting our time, right? So understand that there's more than just lead. There's 10. And as this new quest begins, we'll start going through all of the elements in this kind of information so that way it becomes crystal clear to everyone here what exactly is going on. And let me look at the board here. I didn't want to make today's show a long show, but I do want to make sure I reiterate this for individuals to grasp the message, because message is so important. What I'll also do is I'm not going to take verbal calls, but if you have a question and you want to get that question answered, you can type it in the box, astroquest.tv. Obviously, if you're listening to this, you're already there. You can type it into the box, and then I'll get the question, and I'll answer the question here on the board. But I'll tell you, choose your questions carefully. Like, the last thing that we need to be doing these days is wasting time. So if you're going to ask, where do I start, and those kind of questions that are very rudimentary in the tense of how many times that's been explained, it also says that you haven't dived into the information yet. Meaning that you haven't actually allowed it to come into your system and begin to set up the boundaries. And this is why you can become master over yourself. Because if something then dives in, right? This is going through the head, it dives into you, right? And then it starts to divorce, okay? Let's talk about this word, divorce, okay? What is a divorce? It's the vortex, right? So to divide the vortex, right? Now, this is surgery because you don't want to divide a vortex generally, but when you have to do some refining and you have to do some laws, some rules, some edicts and decrees within yourself, not within the external reality, but within yourself mainly, which makes the reality that you're around form and fashion itself to it based on the field that you're throwing off, it becomes then time for you to take in or dive into some information and begin to separate. Oh, you're supposed to be, okay, you're a part of this state of consciousness, and then you're more a part of this state of consciousness. Now I know that I have two states of consciousness. So, and this is how you begin to go through the knowledge, right? You see the caudaceous staff here. Let me see a thing, the pole. Actually, let me draw another one here. And then we have these two poles. And then when they come up here, right? And this is for you, your temple. Okay, this is temple one. Temple two, and this is white snake, not the group, and black snake, black snake, black snake, not necessarily Nagas. So you have this whispering going on in the mind continuously, and this is like the good angel and the bad angel, you know, angel wings, right? And the good angel and the bad angel are in your temple, and they are suggesting things. Black snake has its own stance, and then white snake has its own stance. And what this does is it constantly generates this energy so that your auric field continues to spin. So there is a use for this, basically, in somewhat keeping alive. If you don't understand what this really is and get it under control, then you cannot travel this middle path, which we talked about just before. You can't not reach quintessence from over here in 6-degree water. You must bring it all back to the center by traveling the straight and narrow path, right? Not dealing with Cain, not dealing with Abel, or Baal and Enki, right? Or we can go on forever and ever with these words, because these are the one is internal, tends to speak more on the internal sense to your spirit. It always wants to be right, and I'll explain that here. You see that Abel was the first one, according to these texts, to die. So that means he was the first one to enter into the astral plane, meaning that the thoughts from that kind of entity in your temple have to do with more of a spiritual dynamic than the physical world, while Cain became the king, right? And then the king and the gold became the gold god. But still, king was Cain, which gives us Canaan,
right? Which gives us a canine, which gives us why God, spelled backwards, is dog. Because the God that is trusted is a guard dog, basically a protector. That's why I said it's a weapon. It's something that you can use against others. And that's why people prey on each other. So here's another thing that I want to talk about why the vortex. What you're dealing with is the vortex. And this is a V, people, okay? Let's just take it for what it is. Many of the English letters are just triangles in different directions, but that's sometimes just what needs to be known. Go that way, right? So you have this as the vortex, okay? Okay? Okay, and this is two V's. Okay, two V's give you a W, two V's give you an M. If you take the W and the M and you fold them back together, they make triangles. And the D's make triangles, right? And the V's make triangles. So you could just keep going through the English language and you'll just figure out this is the Sumerian cone language again. And it's just, it's at us with another spell. So what happens is that in the vortex, okay, because this is another way of seeing what I was explaining earlier today. When you have people going around in these degrees, now this is just a different way. By the way, most of these symbolisms are just from different perspectives. There's either a 2D way to see it, 3D way, 4D way, 5D, etc. And that's where the variations in the symbolism comes, but they're the same symbols. So you got 9-degree fires in here, right? And then you got 20-degree airs, right? And these, of course, make up this hierarchy. These degrees make up this hierarchy or ladder of what's called light. Then there's this Midgard or vacuum period. And this is why they always say, oh, the world has this other world that's lower than it. But there's this middle point, which is where you where you leave, basically. That's the point you dip out. So our experiences are caught up into these vortexes, and many of these experiences have been pulling us down. And I'll talk about this because I want people to understand, I'm not saying that you need to get pulled down in order to get out of this thing. What I'm saying is that when you can merge all of these powers and all of these energies into a grand experience and then say, okay, it's time for me to expand beyond that, that is a form of meditation that actually gets you out of your body, because this is the body. The body itself is constructed of two circumambulating poles, and so they always denote that as either two triangles, and obviously you put these two together, this gives you six, which is the sex. I said it on the show the other day, sex is on fire, I believe. That's what I'm saying. But it's six is on five, okay? And that creates 11, and then this is the dualistic plane, and that's all they're doing with the geometry here. They're just mating in the pentagram with the hexagram and then just continuously generating through a dualistic plane. It's summed up within this. So this same construct, and even within the word DVD, which is the code name for David, right? DVD, this is David. So you take the D as a triangle and then the other D as a triangle, right? And then they used to call this the nail. And then you draw the nail in and then it makes it three-dimensional. It brings it into this reality. And if people think I'm just playing with words, this is not true. Again, I talked about open being the O, right? And then the pin, which is the pentagram, and then that creating an occult symbol with the word. And there's multiple words that are like this. I've scanned a great deal of them. They'll definitely be in the new book. And this kind of knowledge ultimately leading to the redundancy of understanding exactly what is going on here. So what then you have here with this is if you get pulled down here, and this is what I want to warn people about. If you get pulled down here, the degrees of what is happening here, this is when people are using black magic. This is when people are using spells on each other. This is when people are hating each other. This is when there's scarcity. Everyone feels like things are compressing in, not growing, okay? And that's why centripetal or centrifugal is the key. Wherever you're at on this, if you're here and you're running in centripetal or the proper direction, we'll just say, then it feels like, man, I'm expanding, man, I'm getting into totality. Likewise, for the other individual that may be on this side of things, when they keep it, man, this is getting more massive. Wow, this is incredible. You see what I mean? So it's just based on your state of mind on where you popped out in the dimension. And this is why I was explaining to people this natural reincarnation process is bringing us through multiple zodiac signs. Let's take the zodiac here, right? Which is in the tarot, which is Sator, okay? Which is Rhodus, okay? Which means to rotate. That is the secret of the word, because it is a wheel, right? So this is a wheel. And that's what this whole thing with the zodiac and everything was based on, is the wheel. So what you have then is that, let's look at it from the sky, from the air ball. If I drop in here, or here, 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 anywhere beside here, I'm dropping in on the unbalanced side. And this is why I see why this whole myth is hidden within the Jesus story and why it's become so powerful for people, but it's become a very dense interpretation, because this particular point here is the sun. Because in every tense, this is galactic core. So to become a sun being, the sun club, I don't even call it a sun god, right? But to become that, it only means you center yourself, and by all means, you'll feel Christ-like energy in Kundalini, because Christ is still Kundalini, right? So this is where the metaphor was. If you were balanced, you can come into dimensions just like this. And that was your symbol. Like, look, I'm already on the balance thing. Like, this is superior to whatever it is that you're doing over here, 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 here. And I understand that, but I understand that this is also Capricorn, right? And I understand that this is Libra. And then I understand that this is Centauri. And all the different elements and essences, because remember, this stardust is really just containing everything from the periodic tables in different mixtures. And that's why, oh, everything wants to be so different, right? And this is because it's all on different levels of the pole. Thinking individually, like, oh, I'm this, and I've become this, and I'm going to remain this, while the Magnetars, Rigel, Betelgeuse, Aldebaran, our sun, etc., have figured out a way to center themselves. And obviously, they're not males, and this is why the problem with our planet is the spell, because the sun indeed becomes the sun, and a sun is a man, but that sun means a boy, okay? This is not true, because a sun, which is a dynamo or a generator, sun is then sin. And you'll just understand that all these words, when you drop the vowels, it's really just the S. And the S in itself, if you take two S's and you put the other S right there, you get the infinite, right? And so this symbol duplicated creates infinity. But what are they saying? It is a dynamo, okay? It is a generator. Right? It contains a positive and a negative in order to be able to do that. So a boy, in a tense, is only a positive. Where is the negative? So a son is the spell. When you think that the son is a man, I even saw somebody doing it the other day. They were so wise, but then they kept referring to God as a man. And I'm like, man, when is this going to stop? He and he and he. And here's another thing that I'm definitely girding myself up to deal with, because, you know, the buffoonery just has to cease. By all means, there has to be a passage that people are able to obtain in order to get to their higher levels of spirituality. That passage must not be blocked. And that's what I'm here to do. By all means, it cannot be blocked. We're coming with a higher level of universal laws. So if individuals feel like they want to tune into that and get ready to expand, they have to be able to do that. That's where we're coming from. So it's about this. Now then, in our lives, we find ourselves like these seeds. And I'm going to take a break here for a minute and then come back. And I'm going to talk about this. Right? And the reason why you know you're a seed is because there's things you don't know. So if you think you know everything, then you cut off your energy, because then there's nothing else to do. Right? There's always something to know. So the reason why that is the case is because for us now is because we are seeds. We are seed men.
right? Or semen. Now, we talked about this word because there's a lot of new listeners today about man. If man meant masculine, right? Male. And let's see, there's a million other words that are mean masculine things. My mind is somewhere else right now. But if this all meant a male or masculine, then why does it have ma in it? Why is ma there? If this was all about just the man, why is the woman built in the name? It's because the secret that man and woman are the same. They are only the externalization of two polarities that generally exist within the orb of the body of the universe, meaning in the sun. As we talked about caudaceous before, you see the caudaceous then here, and then this being the sun then, right? So where is man and woman? Here. Man's here. Woman's here. You have the vehicle that is in the externalization. You have this man and this woman, but in the internal planes, in the expanse of the inception of the unbegotten, man or woman are not separate. What you see them doing is you see them disembarking from the vehicle, and this is why when you get the story of Adam, woman was removed from Adam's rib. Okay, so what does that mean? That means that woman was already inside of Adam, okay? But if people won't accept that, let me just turn around. Ma, da, okay? Daddy, mommy. Okay, in the same body, right? So the goal here is, what you see there actually achieving this goal, is making us war and fight with each other. Imagining that man's on one side and woman's on another side, and that they have nothing to do with each other, and we haven't been traveling throughout the galaxy together, and that they're actually our opponents. We're each on opposite poles so that we should go to war with each other. We are polarized in order to be generating energy, which is what we're doing, but we're generating energy out of conflict. And this is why I was saying about gross interpretations of things versus the purified interpretation of things. Because when we see each other as dual roles for us to compete, then we've seen each other in the wrong light. We are in dual roles to do what we are doing, which is to generate life. So with two, a man and a woman, we create another one. So for any kind of beings that were just expanding, this was the thing to do. Especially on a physical plane. So realize the trickery that's going on, because our world is beautiful. These days, I watch all these movies, and because I have to pull out all the programming and deprogram it and then put it in my annuals. And I notice how when you look at Earth as a planet, it is so beautiful. Then when you look at other planets, or what they depict as other planets, there's no trees, it's all dead, it's all blown up. So don't let them ruin this planet for you, meaning that tap into, at this point, if this thing just shuts off, make sure that you have another system to transcend into, which is basically what I'm explaining here today. Your light body, it's here, it exists. There are others that know it exists. It's based on real principles, not fairy tales. People are believing spirituality now. I tune into this Cobra guy. He's Cobra saying this all over the, he's the resistance that's been underground for 35 years. And he comes in with the new age message talking about things are getting done. And he's not even pointing people back to themselves. This kind of stuff. These kind of things that are going on in our world that everyone else seems to be taking it for a joke. Meanwhile, we're in a crucible. It only takes a couple situations for this thing to turn into something like Cambodia. And if we don't start realizing that and keep our world in its proper sphere, meaning ourselves, we will not be available for that next transmission that gives us the insight on what we need to do for our spiritual existence, which goes on infinitely. So there is this big thing then without people not wanting to necessarily wake up.
But I'm telling you, you should start letting other things incite you to wake up. There's the reward system. I mean, if you activate this vehicle, you will achieve great things that are beyond what you could ever even fathom on your in your lower state of consciousness. I'm just showing you how it's obvious that you are the supreme being. To achieve it is to start to center yourself into that truth. And then start to make that refinement. Start using the elements, the fire, the water, the earth, the air. Excuse me. You want to begin to use the elements in their proper measures to balance your system. And there are some sites that lend certain tests, even though Tom did say that one of the tests didn't come back well at all. So we're going to scan a little bit more. So we're coming with a questionnaire that allows people to truthfully figure out where they're more polarized at. I think that should be a part of the quest. And then begin to work their way back into the center so they can achieve high spin and not this consistent dualistic zigzag, which is basically chaotic vibratory frequency of a person who is in a dual state of mind. So let's take a break for just a second. I'm going to go ahead and check and see if there's any question. And if not, we're going to go ahead and close out the show for today, because I believe that I feel the next season coming on. So we're going to start to prepare things for that. And I feel like today's conversation is just an example of what will be contained within that season, but also something that you can use right now to begin to immediately work on yourself and then realize, and I'll say this one more time, please realize that when you get an individual that is over here on their pole, they can go through lifetimes without ever realizing that there's even other elements. And this is key. You have to realize this, or it could be a very, very troublesome time here on the planet. And this is, again, if someone is way over here and they're just completely earthly, they don't believe that there is anything beyond Earth, right? That state of consciousness is so polarized, it's going to take several lifetimes of moving back into the center, the more central side of their being. Okay, but this also accounts for why you have people that insist that nothing else is really going on, because they're extremely polarized. They only have a dense understanding of what they're seeing in the reality. Like I said, they're not seeing this reality. Man, this thing is loaded. We got all these trees. Man, let's start taking these trees apart. Let's start synthesizing things. Let's get things categorized. Let's look at etymology. Let's see if someone did most of the work for us. Where's universal law? Let's get into it like that. So that's how you go into this. Like somebody says, you know, be positive about it, or look at how they play the game. I emailed this on put this on Facebook, but when they say be right, I said, man, people have been doing what's right so long that they have no chance but to do what's left. It's like, you know, you start doing one thing over and over and over and over and over and over again, and you think that that's right, and then all of a sudden one day you decide you don't want to do that anymore. So the only thing that then remains is what's left, right? So then you need to ask yourself, is right an actual pole? Yes, it's polarized. Even though it is white snake, even though it does feel like and seem like that is the best thing, or whatever the bliss or the high-ranked seraphim nature, it seems like it is the right thing to do. And then you got over here the left, there's a left-hand path, and then they try to connect that with woman, oh, it's evil, spell, and traps, and all this, right? And then they tell you all that, and stay on the right side, right? But they're both lying. Okay, they're trying to create, let me see, the lie is life, because life is a file, right? And if you play around and then live here, it will get evil only because the ignorance of our interpretation, which is prevalent, meaning how can you interpret such things? Because the apex being, which is basically the human species, we're the gardeners, we're the ones supposed to be taking care of things, is living out a life of fantasy where it doesn't even understand the real principles are more entertaining than what's coming on TV and what new movie they're going to make, right? So we see that instead of being right or instead of being left, then you are centered, right? You understand the value of being centered, okay? And that's here. And then once you do that, if you wanted to see what it looks like from the side, it looks like this. Yeah, you can draw many of these diagrams. You can even put the person in the spine. As long as the spine is there, right? But if you're over here, and they even draw the hierarchies like this, and you're in all these different spaces, everything but here, then this energy doesn't start. And then I'll tell you the last way about this in a very rudimentary way. Within what they call a top. This is that little bitty thing that they spin around, right? Top. Now with a top, when it has slow spin, right? Slow spin, it wobbles, right? So they say, well, Earth has a wobble. That's because it's spinning too slow. Because when you have high spin, right, you don't wobble. You actually come more towards the center, right? The center of it. And so this is why if you get slow and sluggish and sleepy and your spin goes down and your breath becomes shallow, you start to become polarized very easy, right? It's easy, and then stuck into a pole, right? But then if you're spinning very fast, you whoop, right out the top. And many people have associated that with this ringing in the air that gets really, it gets higher and higher and higher and higher, and then pretty soon it's just all white for a moment, and then after that you're projecting. Anything that you want to see or want to do starts to become visual within your third eye. And obviously, the third eye is concave triangles, as you'll see with 528 hertz. And what is that? That's basically that field of rotation of generation of energy, such as the Sri Yantra. And then that center point called the Bindi, meaning the actual point where you get into the center. And that's, I believe, what they're attempting to do with the Kaaba, or whatever is inside of the Kaaba, as we're talking about. Is attempting to get the people to do is send all that energy into the center so that way it coalesces there and it can be removed. So let's take a break. And let me just make sure that there's no questions, or if there is, let me make sure I address those questions. And then we'll begin on that when I come forward. All right, so the question is here, what can we do to overcome temptations, basically? It's quite an extended question, but it does boil into that. And because obviously there is a... There's a programming, and I guess MK Ultra is another topic that we're going to be bringing up on another show that I'm doing with Dino, the Dino Dean show, I believe. But basically, I'm going to get into how, what you're really dealing with when you're talking about your chemical change. And this is one thing that I started to really look deep into, with how many different phenomena can really be caused based on chemical changes in your body. And if in a tense, is there any difference? Meaning, is there a difference between what we call spirituality and chemical phenomena in our body? Because if we have this low interpretation of spirituality, and that only equals us seeing some type of external phenomena like an extraterrestrial or something move or shake, it's not very difficult for many different things to actually cause that phenomenon. But should that be an actual definition and also a conclusion to what spirituality really is? And I talked about how the basis of now what people understand spirituality to be is something more of like X-Men, where you can, you know, read people's mind and you can throw lightning from your hands, and then if anyone does anything wrong to you, oh my goodness, look out, because you can actually destroy them. And that is Vortex kind of behavior, Vortex programming, Project Vortex. And it basically is that V-based, Phi-based, or fighting-based agenda. And it has to do with polarities, which is black versus white. There's one guy who I believe did an excellent job, even though he's still clinging on hold to the Jesus concept, not looking into the more purist version of that story, but he gives an excellent example of exactly the whole array of what the Jesuits have really done with the planet as far as where they want to go now with their polarizations, because they've already separated man from woman. And the next move is to obviously begin to separate the races or divide the colors again. And for an alchemist, this is also what you have to realize is a dark side to alchemy, in a sense where if somebody wants to isolate each color and each segment into, well, the dark side is that it exists. I would just say that. The dark side is that it actually exists. What is it? A boundary. What is the boundary? It makes these colors yellow, red, green. Something has to set a line there, or like a glass. I always love to refer to it as a glass, because you don't even see it there, but you're still trying to figure out how to get through it and what it even is. Meaning, if you don't know what glass is and you happen to come into contact with it, or it's around you like you're in a glass bubble, the levels of confusion that can ensue, if you use this as, I use this as a brain technique to see the minds of other people. If you can understand the chaos that can ensue if a person doesn't see the boundary that's around them because it's hidden. Now, there's another level to this, and that is, of course, a simpler level, is when you have a society that has something like what they just discovered with the banking system, which just came up, like maybe, let's say, 8 years ago. People have been talking about it for a long time, but the masses just received it like 8 years ago. And so you see this wall that basically says that actually, as far as the ownerships and as far as, you know, these names and these marks and sovereignty and all these different topics, like, this is something that we don't choose to educate you in. You have to either figure that out yourself. Actually, they don't even go into that. They just, you don't need to know about this, right? And so that's something that's just recently been uncovered. So to me, that's glass in the reality. And I need to get some water here for a minute. Let me just take a second and get some water. But that's the glass in the reality. It's like something that nobody really perceived was going on until someone discovered it. And so that's also what we are. We're discoverers, we're travelers, we're explorers. That's our original nature. Our nature is not to sit around like robots and wait to be acted upon so that we can react. That's not our state. So it also puts me in a very interesting position. I want people to know that, you know, my life and what I'm dealing with just more in my spiritual being and more in my mental being is very immense because of I'm still staying stable throughout all this. And I had recently an individual come in and exclaim that in all of the teachings from the different people he's researched and studied, it was very difficult for an individual to keep this Kundalini energy under control so that it didn't tear up their life around them. Obviously, I have a wife and I have a child. And also, you know, you don't want to get too polarized with your power, your energy, especially on a physical plane, and then run into one of these massive planets that are just super dense. It's almost like you'll sometimes confront forces that they are very lethargic in a tense where obviously they're slow and dense moving forces on this planet now. And this also becomes states of mind that we go through, by the way. And I believe that, and that's why I say today is going to be more of like a candid interview of what exactly it's like to be involved in a heavy level of spiritual expansion for this planet, really. Not sitting back on some strange Nigerian scam type message, siphoning money off the people. Like, all I see in the arena these days is that, where individuals have attached themselves to the talisman so heavily, they don't even understand how it works, meaning that when you attach yourself to anything and you don't know how it works, like the money or the dollar, I was thinking of the other day, people don't understand. R is the symbol of the pentagram, so a dollar is a dollar, basically a pentagram body, an actual person walking around, and so that's why it has the head, it has the magnetic strip, it has those four fathers who created the door in every tense. That's what the whole Tetra situation is about, the number four. They are alive in the currency still. It's like, it's the heaviest level of magic that you can really think of here. But on other planetary systems, this is like somebody kicked you in the balls in a tense, literally. It's like, nobody uses this kind of Vulcan knowledge, as they term it. This is when you disarm an individual from their internals, and then you watch the slow decay and feed off of that. That's really the vortex. That's how it's generating itself. And some people want to know, why does it exist and all that stuff? And this has to do with such massive dynamics that still ultimately fuel the worlds that we're in. It has never been deemed that it shouldn't be a world without darkness or ignorance, because there's always something for the light to penetrate, because the light in itself is the seed. It's basically a projection, as I talked about the other show, it's a projection or a projectile from the actual source, and it contains a blueprint of the source, and it attempts to embed in the deepest darkness, And then if it falls on fertile ground, then it starts to grow up through experiences until it turns not only itself into the original source, but also the original source plus all the experiences again of what it took to become the original source. And then you have infinite amount of beings doing this simultaneously, which creates a stream of immortality.
So I start thinking.
The first thing is, again, to understand, it's like there's going to be a difference between people who are actually experiencing this versus the people who are just keep talking about it. Like, I'm experiencing this. I'm not reading just about this in the book, but I'm still reading books, meaning that I don't actually think that I know everything and that I figured it all out. I seek for a greater understanding in order to balance myself, and I'm really into this. And so that, with that intention bolted onto the people's plight, meaning that I've met some beautiful people as I've been on the path that I really sincerely wanted to metamorphosize into a more balanced level and found myself inequipped to do that. For me, it's still something to the great of sadness of when a person that's close to you is dead. But even deeper, because the person is actually alive and you're watching them being sucked into this vortex. And meanwhile, you're trying to anchor yourself and even gain your bearing. And this is what we call the, you know, the captain's journey across the sea and how to become the surfer of these waves of frequencies. Because somebody asked a question, and I start, you know, rolling some of these questions in here. Somebody asked me, you know, how do you overcome this, man? Sometimes think if you don't. Like, I notice very hard-headed people seem to need to get it really straight, and sometimes I have to instill myself because I have a solid core in many ways. So if I have to chisel myself, I have to come in with a deeper tool. And I'm like, man, if you don't get this together, I don't know what makes you think. Nothing around you in this world has ever showed you that it's just going to be okay. If you don't discover it now and not wait on someone to discover it for you or fall asleep trying to discover it, you need to really be concerned. Because just think about it. If you're concerned and then you discover it, all the more the merrier. But if you don't, and something actually does emancipate you and help you, then hey, great. But if that doesn't happen, which is how a person, a sovereign, is going to check stern like that, meaning they're going to make sure that the rigging is correct in order for them to be able to begin to sail if they are to be fully conscious of their experience, and because that's what they inherit. And it's like, if you become super present within yourself and you just realize, man, the sheer fundamentals of you standing on the ground is enough for you to jump off this thing, meaning that for you to jump off the body to become back in love with yourself, because this is what all this has to do with. When we put our love into external things, it is indeed going out. Let us not be confused. And when we bring love back in within and we take care of ourselves, it is indeed going in. So just as everything in this world has a breathing in and breathing out, be sure that you get a fair measure of these two, right? And so I'll say that's the other side of this. Some people need to now know, look, if you don't get this together with this kind of knowledge available on the dimension, we're even going into some more expansive things here in a couple of weeks where the high spin has been obtained. But the reality is that the condition of the vessel in which any type of rejuvenating element would be placed in, it would need to first balance that individual. And so now what we've come across indeed is elements that can balance an individual, but what needs to be created is a help desk. This is basically about that each person is so unique or have been experiencing. Look, you're unique because you experience different things. That it even can stop there. So when a person goes to work on you and to do something with you to help you correct your bearing, it's almost like they need tools that actually fix massive issues that are deep within the psyche or deep within the aura. So they even need the energy. They need the tool, the pen, the penetration of their own light or their own seed. And then they need to actually have the accuracy to go into what exactly you're dealing with, short of reading your mind, and then be able to then neutralize it. That's the other part of this. Some people, they say they swear they can read people's mind and what everyone is doing. It's not that hard these days. Now we have to go deeper in to see, okay,
inside of this individual's mind, and inside, actually not even just their mind, let's take their whole corpus, their mind, body, and soul, let me examine. And then you have to look into all the crevices and all the orifices, which is all the internals and then all the externals, the extremities and all these kind of things of the body. And then that's what someone with the caudaceous staff or the real person that's supposed to greet you at the dock is supposed to do, is supposed to actually make sure that you're healthy. So to me, it's about also that is an immense level of information. We're trying to compress it more, but because of the complexity of the being, it challenges us to see if we're even supreme based on if we can even conceive what is being described, meaning that because of the amount of elements within the individual's body and the different levels of application, because you can go mineral-based, you can go plant-based, you can go through a whole bunch of kingdoms to find an actual solution for this particular person's ailment. It just all depends on if you're a master of any of those kingdoms. And this is also the plight with our species now because of the MK Ultras. It's left in the language, left in an incomplete loop. So when the person is actually looking for the rest of themselves, the rest of the interpretation of who they are, they find it absent. And if you've come into this certain level of thinking now, if you're listening to this program today and you're saying, well, you know, this makes perfect sense to me. Okay, what do I do next? Then you know that you need to turn it on. Like, if you say, okay, what do I do next, but you don't feel what do I do next, it's not turned on. So then you have to go back into the vessel. And then all of the surface stuff, meaning, you know, you just, you know, arguing with your sister all the time, or you just in a disagreement with some people in some situation that's not going to change. The only thing that you're really saying is, I'm stuck in the vortex. I'm on quadrant sickness 912. If somebody can help me, somebody can get my ship has no motor. I have no bearing. That's basically what everyone is saying here. We have to take it into another context. Is there a tow truck out there? Is there someone that actually has enough strength to actually come into the rift and go through the fears of the reefs, dive deep in the water in the ocean? Because actually, we're not just on the surface of the water. We've already sunk because of how long we've been down here. You got these kind of transmissions coming in from different vessels on Earth that have been here for quite a bit of time and first spun, meaning that whatever the currency is, the first one was the oxen, but just spun so much without understanding the direction of your spinning. Like I talk about investing in yourself. This astral investment to make sure that whatever happened, real reality drop out. It's like, okay, I'm stabilized because I'm already melding with a field that I go to every single night. It's not, it's like this, it's like a door you walk through in a certain tense. So that's what I'm saying. So you could take it into different ways of how you get rid of temptation. Either you join in on the magnificent adventure, or you just stay on the side of the bench all the way on the back waiting to not catch the draft next year. That's pretty much where we're at. And if you were looking for that motivation because your chakras are burned out, and that's what the sex does. Now, let me just give you the entire composition of what the sex like through the pornography, or basically just because there's women or men, whatever your fancy is, everywhere on the internet, naked and doing anything and everything. So the first thing that happens, then there's also people in the world, because obviously you want to act out that fantasy, so there's people in the world that you can link up with to do these kind of things, right? What is the actual use of whatever this kind of energy? Because if we turn everything into energy and say this is sexual energy, what is the use of it? So the projection generally is if a person is so focused on just linking with the other individual, there is actually no intention to what they're doing. Like when if one person wants to be attracted to another person so that they can go into the sex or the six, there's no intentions there except for just that. So the only thing basically they person wanted to do was hook up. But they didn't even know once we hook up, what are we going to do? Then if you hook up, and in these type of ecstasies, you begin to generate incubus, succubus, meaning that the actual more distorted, gaseous, ethereal type, or actually more vapor type forms that are generated between when two auric fields with definitely a lot of minerals and stardust come together and then start generating or birthing. So every time you are engaging in some type of sexual activity, you are generating. We're not saying sex is evil. We're saying, are you seeing it in its purity? Meaning that not a Catholic purity, but is your use of it? Like, if a man drops a seed but yet doesn't want the seed to grow, why not store the seed? Think about it from a literal level. Like, I'm a farmer. I got this whole, everything is based on my seeds now. And I have a whole storehouse full of seeds. Or maybe let's just say one bag of seeds. And I'm going to go and start planting these seeds on purpose to where I don't want anything to grow. That is insanity. But it is the same thing as when a man actually drops a seed in a woman and doesn't want to have a baby. That's it right there. So in one perspective, you can see it as something that you may not have no debt to. In another way, you've realized, man, this has every single meaning to the entire scope of life, because what I plan and where I planted is what I will have to eat. So there's the physical seed, though, and then there's the idea, meaning that the idea, which is just the debasing of the other individual in a certain tense and an extraction of energy or pleasure, and that's why there's a climax or an orgasm, and then there's a leaving from that point, and the stronger vessel takes the energy. Because why? Because the other vessel was exhausted first. So we need to start just thinking about this stuff on other dynamics. Like, we've gotten into the oochie-coochie and in all of this birds and the bees and in the cooties and all this stuff so much that we're not seeing this is basic dynamo knowledge. Like, you need high spin now. Like, you have to be able to patronize with the universe, not this situation that you're dealing with on this dimension, meaning that you have to be able to tap into energies that allow you to expand. And also to understand the fundamentals and principles behind contraction. So if you are just basically frolicking everywhere, like the person pushing the mouse pushing the pleasure button, then if you have enough knowledge in you to say, okay, well, now I need to understand the seed. You have books like Montauk Chai. If this is a male asking the question, I have names. You have Montauk Chai, Multi-Orgasmic Man. That lets you understand how to begin to work with the energies, to begin to send the energies into the proper channels. Then you go from there. And then obviously woman has her applications within understanding the directions in which her energy is sent through the cycles, which is another conversation, but one we can definitely get into at another time. The question here is, what elements can be utilized to neutralize EMF pollution? The reality is that EMF pollution, if anything, is to be around you that cancels this. And this was like a deep fringe thought that I had quite some time ago about whether you could wear a suit that would actually repel all signals. Well, the first thing is that say goodbye to any kind of cell phones, any kind of other devices that you or other individuals around you are using. So when I started to research that, I realized that that was actually a jammer. And obviously there's a whole range of frequencies that could be programmed within it, which is probably more of its applicable use, but you would have to first understand the frequencies that you're actually blocking. And then also when you're causing these blockages, what that may create. So just on a surface level, obviously jammers are not even legal in the United States. But what they do is they shut down massive communication fields because they cancel out those frequencies. Whether that creates an environment with no frequencies or not has not been determined, because obviously if two frequencies cancel each other out, they're consistently doing that, so the field is still present. So thus, anything that you can wear or says it deflects EMF fields, it cannot be true, because EMF fields are penetrating even also on a cellular level. What you can do, though, is make sure that those fields do not have the right kinds of metals to amplify through inside of your body. These are like the metallic toxins that are within your body. When you get these EMF fields coming through, they have to attract to something. Now, also, this EMF field obviously attracts to the certain states of mind, and that's also done in the programming. So when you find yourself free from the programming, a sovereign is indeed installed with an internal immune system of high spin, which basically creates a being that does not pull in anything into its field that is actually non-harmonic with it. So I'll just leave it at that. So remember, this whole getting rid of EMF pollution, it should be more turned into individuals understanding how to get
the metals out of them that are reflecting off of these EMF fields. So the next question here is, can we talk about vibrational wavelengths and how that works with this? And I believe I discussed that earlier. This person says, seven, what can you say about the Indian yogis and the spiritual tactics they use in enlightenment as compared to the modern Western tactics such as yoga and meditation? Again, one is from the other. So that's probably would sum up what I exactly feel about it. You see that the Eastern traditions have been taken apart and dissected and then bought in the American tradition piece by piece as it continuously is interpreted. And I think that's as much as I need to say about that. But basically, one versus the other, it's clear the one that preceded the one that is replicating it is going to end up being much more perfected. Next question here is, spinning into the vortex, becoming centered. It is all or nothing now. There are no in-betweens. Basically, the question is, are there any in-betweens? Yes, we just mapped out the in-between. The in-betweens are the actual poles of the zodiac sign. It's when you take a certain stance, whether it's a Capricorn stance, or whether it's a Libra stance, or whether it's, you know, Aries stance. When you take that kind of stance into the reality and you begin to react out, I would say, your role in it. Because remember, there's someone says, well, this universe is going to stop. This universe doesn't have a problem with this. The universe is using all of this stuff in weights and measures on grander scales. You don't know. We may be extremely imbalanced over here, and that be correcting an imbalance somewhere else based on how the system is designed. The reality is that can you balance yourself, achieve the high spin, and be able to come right out of the center of your body so that you come in and come out as you please? Of course, this makes the pin then only a shell or a shield, but meaning the pentagram, but not your prison, which is the difference in the interpretation. And I realized that this was going to get everything down to two different kind of religions finally in this world. And it was going to be basically the Anunnaki believers, the ones who believe that man was shaped in form and fashioned by some other race and that they created us, et cetera, et cetera. Never realizing that is the Archon Yadav-Bael story and the fallen angels and the rest of the whole that club. Or that we realize that all of how to create was taken from systems just like this planet. And it doesn't need to talk and say what it's doing. Like, you know, the mango tree is not saying, hey, look, I'm producing mangoes. Nature does not want to use English. It uses, let's really get it done. Let's grow some stuff here. So that should give a person really deep insight about, you know, all these traditions and to get a person somewhere and to, you know, read massive books and all of these kind of things. There's light speed now. You know, we figured it out and we can come the other way around. That's what's called evolution in a certain tense. It's like when you go around the circle so many times and you're like, wait a minute, I've seen this before. Hey, I think we should apply this like right now and it'll probably have a massive effect for our entire civilization. But if we choose not to, I believe that the world has an ancient system of cycles that it keeps reincarnating individuals in their worlds of different poles in order for them to eventually become balanced. And this is what I see personally. This person says, what is the first steps to initial steps to restructuring water? And the reality is with water is that it's several different steps. And let me actually, I've had to think of water real quick because my mouth is super dry here. To me personally, out of everything, it's just based on what you have the capability of doing. Obviously, if you have a capability of getting a distiller, it's good to take distilled water and then take it to the next step, meaning that send it through, again, some type of mineralization system, even if it's you adding minerals to it. You got to understand your mineral water is so important because a lot of the conductive size of your body, or i.e. the metallic size of your body, if you see it in the dense way, build themselves based on these minerals. So inside of our system, if we don't have a lot of minerals even in our water, so it's a good, better, best. It's like regular tap water from the city is not better than distilled water, but you don't want to drink distilled water without at least trying to mineralize it. But if you have to choose distilled water over purified water out of the store, distilled water is going to be still more effective than purified water out of the store because of the leaching effects and things in the plastic, etc. So it's like there's different stages of the water. So it's just really about what you can afford. So the poor man's guide to it is something I believe, I think they call this mica. There's actually, it looks like a black dirt and you can put it in the bottom of your cup and it's almost like a carbon. It sucks out all of the bad metals, and then you can just drink right after that because it pulls out all the bad metals. So that's the poor man's guide. And then obviously for the big boy, I guess, if you want to call it that, then you're going to definitely go with something like the distilled water system, and then go into the restructuring of the water, which is something like a Jupiter Athena, and then take that thing through some kind of tube to magnetically restructure that water with N52 magnets put into that the right kind of spiral, and then figuring out, which is the last piece, how you're going to get some kind of stir plate to go with something that can turn its vortex to go in one direction, then stop and go in the other, and keeping the water on a constant spiral in and spiral out. I noticed that with water, once you start structuring it, you really don't want a water that is spinning just to the right or spinning to the left, because when you drink that water, you feel your body, I mean, this is obviously we're deep in the fringe over here, but you feel your body go deep into one of your recesses of your right or left side, depending upon how the water is spinning. This also serves to throw the system off balance and also give you somewhat of a headache. So we realize, oh, this water, it needs to be spun. It needs to be to not be spun at all. Or when you take it into a vortex, bring it left and then bring it right, bring it left, bring it right. And this seems to balance it out. Let's see here. Is everything in the universe a vortex dynamo, which is capable of creating energy from 0 point spark gap? As above, so below? Yes, everything is actually already doing it on its level. So that's just the reality of this. Everything is still generating and acting and in communion on multiple levels with everything else. We just have to accept it as that and keep moving into it. Last question here is, males deplete their energy when expelling their fluids, such is not the case for women. How is woman's energy being depleted then? It is actually being depleted because when the man debases the woman, when he actually does not give her the seed and the feeling of her real worth, then this is like the same thing that the man would then be doing to the earth if he doesn't acknowledge that the food and the abundance that's coming from it is something that we're eating and consuming, and it is alive. You see what I mean? So our thought of what woman really is and how we see her and in what light we see her now is affecting us because it's still a part of us. So when we look at anything, and this is, again, this was obviously a man that asked the question, but it goes the other way. When we look at anything and we cannot see it in its higher light, this is ignorance for us. This is slams the enlightened mind into confusion because what really happens is you're saying that you can't interpret what it is, because for a great soul, everything is great. When you're actually seeing the dynamic of what it can metamorphosize into, that's when you start to that's when you really start to get more into the expanded side of yourself. So Thomas the Messenger said the Montauk Child has a book about women's chi. Yep, Montauk Child has a book about women's chi. I repeat that again. You can read that again. You can check that out when you get an opportunity to. And I thought we might be able to source the book here, but everyone can get Montauk Chai's collection, at least on, I think, Pirate Bay. There's some huge torrent. So that's what we got for today. Like I said, we came in, obviously, I found out at 11 o'clock last night that this was supposed to be a show today. I feel like we got some major principles across and things that we can apply to ourselves that will allow us to actually metamorphosize. I will tell you, I'm already metamorphosized. It's very difficult for me to remain contained at certain points in my energy system. That's why I also, for a minute, I kind of backed off the radio shows, because when you're live on this camera and then you start to deal with those energies, especially when you're getting questions answered and you're working with people, sometimes you have these looks on your face and you're saying different things twice and you may say it wrong because it's live. And then I realized, you know, in radio, none of that occurs because you're so centered and you're not even looking into anything to try to focus into it but yourself. And so that's the difference, I would say, between this camera and radio. But I'm working more myself personally to when I do get in front of this camera. And there's a sourcing of the book. And I guess we're just going to have to actually get this onto the resistance. So anyone wants to check that out, that's astroquest.com. You can get to it. And so that's what's up. I will say thank you to everyone for tuning in, and we'll be forward in a little bit, and that's it. You know, I have a hard time leaving. It's like, no, wait, no. But wholeness. And it's obviously there's a lot going on. This is much more bigger in it. And obviously I have other things that I'm working on that I'm putting the pieces together. Generally, I don't introduce anything until I'm absolutely sure. So what you heard today was really the golden rule, and it tends to how you should treat yourself, is understand you are supreme. Center yourself with the center of yourself, and get out of those poles if you can. And then if you want to give yourself a reason why sometimes it feels like you can't change, you know, man, I'm way too many degrees in the fire. I need to start working with opposing elements. And I am, again, working on something that will assist individuals at balancing out more. But the cleansing is the best place to start. You definitely, like for me, I crawl before I walk. It's a stage of us going through things. Get the cleanse going on and then be able to open the filters is the first step. And then there's the next step going to be available definitely soon. Thanks to everyone. Wholeness.